no!
Hey everybody, it's Andy Kushner with The Wedding Biz, and this is another episode of The Next Level. And together, my co-host and I discuss the most recent interview and suss out a few of the key topics and translate them into specific tactical strategies that you can use to bring your business to the next level. And I'm so excited because today's guest co-host is David Stark. David is a renowned New York City-based event producer and designer whose team creates events worldwide, and just some of his high-profile clients and events include Brad Pitt, Glenn Close, Saturday Night Live's 40th anniversary, Louis Vuitton, and high-visibility events and fundraising galas for the nation's most elite, including the Whitney Museum and the Metropolitan Opera. And David has 5 books published so far. And he's had product collaborations, and David's been a guest expert on many television shows and featured many times in major publications. You all know who he is. And he was also inducted into BizBash's Hall of Fame. And I re-released my first interview with David on The Wedding Biz on December 10th of last year. So I really recommend you go back and hear it. December 10th, David Stark. And after recording today's The Next Level episode with him, I'm going to interview him a second time for a release within a month or two. So David, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for having me back. It's always a pleasure.
Yeah, this is going to be great. So today's interview that we're going to be discussing is Cindy Novotny, founder of Master Connection Associates, an internationally renowned leader in sales, leadership, and customer service. And Cindy's been recognized by the Association of Talent Development as one of the 9 most powerful and innovative speakers. Hospitality Sales and Marketing Association International recognized Cindy as one of the top 25 most extraordinary minds in sales and marketing. And she authored the book Living with No Balance and Loving It. And so this second interview with Cindy, I thought was really fascinating. We had a chance to kind of go a lot deeper into some of these issues that I think we all really think about. And one of them, David, in terms of the first one that grabbed my attention was when she talked about the issue of delegation, delegating responsibilities, but also, and I thought this was a cool angle, wanting to trust people and how she's had moments, I definitely have too, we're just not staying on top of them enough. And so she has this philosophy of confronting issues really directly and how she wants that to be her corporate culture, yet, you know, so many people have a fear of confronting these issues. And so she talked about, you know, having group discussions, one-on-ones. And, you know, how did you feel about this? Is this something you also think about a lot in your own company?
You know, Andy, it is. I mean, it's actually something that we've been working on quite a bit over this last year with a consultant that we hired. And first of all, I want to step outside of this train of thought for a second to say Cindy is a powerhouse. I mean, she is one of the truly inspiring, incredible mountain movers that I've ever seen in action. And so one of the things that I was really fazed by the interview with is she's a person like everybody else is, right? So here's this person whose public persona is she can do anything. She can move mountains. She can inspire anybody. And it was humbling to realize that as a person, as a business owner, she faces the same challenges that we all face. You know, growing up, my grandfather used to say, every person puts on their pants one leg at a time. So it doesn't matter whether they're rich, they're poor, they're famous, they're not famous. So I was really moved by the honesty in Cindy's approach to the conversation and the fact that she faces the same things that we all do.
First of all, I want to say that, yeah, it's really good to see even someone like herself, you know, in terms of what she talks about as a consultant and the confidence that she exudes, and people are hiring her to teach them how to do this and improve. And yet she has her own issues at her company, delegating and then trusting them. And the whole issue of people, you know, if they have some kind of a problem or issue with her or her company, bringing it up and not letting it fester.
Yeah.
You know?
As I was saying, that's something that we've been working on quite a bit. I think it's something, you know, when a business is smaller, it has a smaller amount of people and the founder or the business owner has much more direct interaction on a very daily basis with that smaller group of people. The problems exist, but they don't exist in the same kind of magnitude because you have many more touch points to eradicate potential problems, right? But as a company grows, and Cindy's company, you know, she employs a lot of people. She's always jetting around someplace else, and she's never in the same room for any length of time. And so it becomes more difficult to have those personal touch points. You know, we face that too. I'm not in an airplane nearly as much, but, you know, we have 50 full-time people in our organization. And as we've grown, we've had to look closely at how do we develop a culture where delegation is implicit in it, but not just delegation, also people stepping up to bat to be leaders and to rally around a mission. And one of the things that I've learned a lot about this year with the consultant that we've hired to help us is, you know, I never really thought about it. I just figured anybody that we would hire would automatically know the mission, right? Like the mission was to make really great experiences for people and to do the best job we could. And, you know, I figured that was enough. But what I've actually found is it's not enough. And we've done the exercise of forcing ourselves to come up with words that would be symbolic for what are the things that our company stands for, and having a rallying cry around those mission statements so that everybody is united in their approach of how they deal with each other internally and how they deal with everybody externally to not only make that mission reality, but to perhaps surpass it. And I think that delegation, trust, leadership, all of those things go hand in hand. If everybody could be really unified around what are the goals, then I think you have a little bit of a head start. I think, you know, trust is something one earns, right? You don't just walk in the door and get it. And trust is something that is developed. And, you know, people sometimes in my lifetime have criticized me for not delegating. And then I think, well, I've got all these 50 people plus that are working on things, and we do the quantity of things that we do in a year. How is that not delegation? But I think there's a difference between delegation and empowerment. And just giving somebody a checklist of something to do is not enough to make them rise to the occasion to be a leader. And ultimately, I think what, you know, delegation is the act, right? But leadership is the desire. And so it's not enough to give an assignment, but it's important to assign what are the goals around that and why are we collectively doing this and what do I need you to do as the leader? And at the same time, I've always been very good at giving congratulatory notices when somebody does a really great job about something. You know, I'm the first to shout it out from the rooftops. What I haven't been as good at doing is when something is more challenging, in real time talking about it. And I think that that's really what Cindy was getting at. I wouldn't necessarily use the word confrontation. Confrontation feels confrontational. It feels aggressive. It feels potentially, to me, it has like a little bit of a nasty undertone.
Well, and that's, I think, what people are afraid of. I think that maybe they are afraid to bring something up, especially to management, in case it somehow turns in that direction.
I think that's right. And I think, you know, there's, quote unquote, the fear of getting in trouble. That means different things to different people.
Or looking bad.
Looking bad. That means, you know, maybe you'd lose your job. I mean, it means lots of different things. But I would like to, you know, open the idea to the fact that we all have challenges and we all don't do everything perfectly and we all make mistakes. And we all need direction and we all need inspiration and we all need the reasons why something is a thing to do. And part of, I think, a leadership journey is to be able to talk about the great things that happen between people or the great things that happen on the job, but also to talk about the things that were challenges and give feedback in real time that feels safe. It doesn't feel confrontational. It feels like it's given in the spirit of having us together reach our goals rather than being attacked for something that you, you know, did wrongly. And so the word confrontation feels not like the right word. I understand the goal. The goal is to not let something fester. I think about that a little bit more like, you know, a fight with your girlfriend, boyfriend, husband, wife. You know, I'd like to believe that in the office we're not fighting, but that there are things that we have collective goals that we need to reach. And so I want to take the emotion out of it, and I want to give it a structure that's about learning and about growth and not so much about getting in trouble.
And I want to say, I think that's what Cindy meant. when she was talking about creating a culture, a company culture, about how they're going to deal with it. You know, ultimately, I think that's what she meant, you know. And I like the idea, too. I believe she talked about how when she's interviewing people, they even clarify right up front, look, if this is going to work out, we're going to work together. Here's a few things about the way we work and how she would address that particular issue. You know, which is really, it makes me think too, I've had situations, I mean, look, we're both in the creative arts, creative people, I don't want to stereotype, but I do think there's more sensitivity and I don't want to say more emotional, but in the creative arts business, I do think there's some of that going on. And so, yeah, so that affects this feeling.
Well, I also think people in general are people, right? And so they've got emotions and they've got feelings and they've got disappointments and things that they're excited about. I mean, those are all parts of being people. And so it's ridiculous to think that those are not going to be part of the office workspace. But I do think that, you know, leadership in offices has a responsibility to try to find the difference between emotional responses to things. You know, so often the emotional response, I find, the emotional response to something in the office that might be pegged to a particular work-related thing is most often about something else.
Yeah, it's just like a trigger is what it is, something personal. I always have to hesitate for a moment, David, with somebody, and I forget all the time, like, hold on, maybe this really has nothing to do with me.
So, you know, I think, you know, the reason, at least in my knowledge, of why we set up these words that are what the company is about, the mission words, is because if we have this thing that grounds us, that we're all united upon, then when we're doing the work that we're doing, it all is under the eyes of going back to that. So, you know, for example, for us, those words are about being a partner to our clients. They're about innovation. They're about being visionary, and they're about storytelling. And so if ultimately at the end of the day, that's what we're rallying around, then things that happen throughout the course of a workday, whether that's with each other or with a client or with a vendor that we work with, they all go back to those core beliefs.
There's like a foundation built to support this.
And when we veer away from that, a problem arises. We're able to pull it back to what those words are, or the meaning of those words, so that we're not criticizing somebody personally for something. We're bringing back to what the mission of the organization is.
And maybe to remind them too. Because it is kind of natural for people to get a little defenses up and take it personally.
Yeah, I think so.
I have something really special to talk about. It's our sponsor for today, and believe me, we check them out thoroughly. We don't just take anyone. So I want to say that if you need more presence in the market and you're wondering how to accomplish that, you need to check out OFD Consulting. They are an award-winning publicity agency that focuses on the wedding industry. Their client portfolio ranges from top-tier planners and venues to well-regarded national brand and industry thought leaders. OFD Consulting has placed clients in a slew of popular online and offline publications, and they also have a service dedicated entirely to B2B press. So for those looking to elevate your brand reputation among peers through online mentions, guest articles, podcasts, and speaking engagements, you've got to contact them. And one more piece of information, I want to tell you that if you are a small business, and most of us are, and you want to dip your toes in the PR waters, check out the OFD Collective, which is a three-tier membership with robust educational and coaching opportunities, along with ongoing press leads. So check out OFDconsulting.com. God, we could talk forever about this, but this is great to cover it. I think it's so important for us to think of, especially as entrepreneurs. You know, I want to move on to another topic. She talked about pricing, and, you know, pricing, I say that word.
Everybody's favorite topic.
It's such a sensitive thing, but some interesting things came up. So, and we all have our different, you know, ways of doing it, but she said that she prices to what she feels she's worth. And if a client can't afford her, okay, move on. I mean, both of you move on. And also that so many people are talking about, you know, like we've talked about Engage, there's been talks about, you know, you got to raise your prices. And I think in some cases that's absolutely apropos, people not valuing themselves enough. But what happens when you're not real busy? you know, in this whole issue of, I hate the word discount, but you know, she was making the point, you got to pay rent and you got to do payroll. And you know, what do you do with pricing? And she was saying, it's all about demand. It's a complicated topic.
Yeah. I mean, I think that Cindy did a really beautiful job of showing sort of the complexity of the issue. And I agreed with pretty much everything she said. You know, for me, it's definitely not black and white. It is also very different everywhere. Not every single state, not every single city, not every single town, not every single place in the world, every country has the same kind of demand as everything else. And, you know, let's face it, those that work in the luxury wedding market, it's just that, it's a luxury. So it's not something that I think can have a set menu of prices that are applicable to every place, every situation, every person, everywhere. And I think that's unrealistic. I think it's, I don't even see the value of it, to be perfectly honest. And, you know, what I think that Cindy was really talking to was that there needs to be some flexibility built into that. Of course, we should all value ourselves. Value is not just what that means financially. Value comes from lots of different things. The track record you have with your clients appreciating the work you do, the emotional charge you get from making somebody's most special day special, the fact that you are able to pay your employees, that's value. The fact that artistically you feel really satisfied by this plateau that you reached on a project, that's value too. There's lots of different ways to attribute value, and that's not only what the check was written for. So entering into that equation, and listen, we all need to eat, we all need to pay for our stuff, we all are going to retire someday. I mean, it's not saying that those things aren't tantamount of importance, they certainly are. But building a career, which is essentially in a creative industry, has many shades of gray of what brings us there and why we stay there. And at the same time, I agree with Cindy all the way. I mean, if there is a time period where you're less busy and you want to be busier, you might be more flexible.
And, you know, when I interview you for our one-on-one for your second one, you know, we can get into certain aspects of this too in more depth. But when things aren't as busy, my concern, I face this myself, is that what are people going to perceive? I mean, not that people talk, although some do, they know each other in the community, but I'm concerned about diluting what I've set and established. I mean, do you just straight out say to people, look, it's a slower season, I want to be, how do you handle it?
I was vibing more on what Cindy was talking to. If somebody comes to her and says, you know, I want you to speak in April, and she says, well, this is my price. And they say, well, that's going to be hard for us. She says, well, you know, I could be a little bit more flexible in this month.
Or if it's right, I got you.
So she's not, you know, giving away the farm, but she's offering a flexible solution that could be good for both parties. Mm.
And it doesn't dilute her brand.
So it's not about saying, well, you know, it's a fire sale. You're, you know, going to get the same service that would have normally been $10 for $5. She's having a creative approach to meeting the client so that they feel heard and helping, you know, her calendar at the same time.
You know, and I'm sure that there is always a creative way, it's all creative, on how to present it in that way.
I think that's right. I mean, I don't believe that people at a certain level in our industry are being hired because they were $5,000 cheaper than somebody else, or $10,000 or $20,000. Like, that's ultimately not the reason why somebody was hired over somebody else. There's certainly an awful lot of emotion and personality that's part of that decision-making process. And there's certainly, you know, vibing on the taste level of what that person or that company represents. You know, one designer's aesthetic may be entirely different than another designer's aesthetic. Their price might be equal, or their price might be different by a couple thousand dollars. But the decision there is probably about the aesthetic choice than it is about this one was cheaper than that one. So I don't agree with this idea that at this level, at this plateau, that is something that is truly a deciding factor. And I think it's a little bit more about our own personal insecurities than it might be about something external in the marketplace.
You know, and it's going to lead us to the last topic I want to cover related to what you just said before we go is I think we're talking about people's fear guiding them in that sense. And so setting that aside, I love how you're framing this whole conversation about pricing and that fear element. And well, let's go into it, you know, because it is related. Cindy was talking about how she deals with fear. Now, in the first interview with her, she talked a lot about turning fear into a motivator. So we covered that. But this time, you know, coming back to even this issue, okay, economic fear, because we were talking about pricing. And she was talking about the having the ability to look past what's going on and don't spend energy trying to, you know, say that, oh my God, economy is going to just drop or trying to predict what the future is. Just do the job. But there is this insecurity and fear in maybe your personal life that carries over into business and vice versa.
Look, Cindy stated this so clearly. I mean, you can't predict the unknown. You can't solve for the unknown. And if you live your whole life in fear, then you don't do anything. And, you know, this isn't a dress rehearsal. This is the one life you have. So, you know, my point of view would be go out and do everything you want to do. There's always something that you can do to retrench, right? I mean, sometimes we talk about, you know, the last market crash and what we did and how we handled it. And, you know, there was some fear involved and we acted swiftly and we made some changes. We cut some expenses. We marketed ourselves differently. And we obviously were all fine. We've all lived past that. So we have proof in our prior histories, if you're old enough for that. So younger folks that haven't experienced that in that way.
But heard about it.
So for everybody who heard about it and didn't experience it, we all survived. And it's a new day. And or many new days have happened since. And, you know, it's a cycle. And, you know, one of the things that I've learned with the length of time that I've been in business is that things that I used to worry about, I actually realize are sort of conquerable. And so I don't worry so much about like, how are we going to deal with what if? Because, you know, being an event producer is very much, you know, thinking on your feet. It never works out like it was planned on paper. So being in business is very much like being an event producer. You can't predict everything. You could have a plan. You should have a plan. But when the plan changes, you have to be reactive to that and you have to be cool-headed and you have to be thoughtful and you have to think about, okay, great. This is now what I'm dealt with and this is how I'm going to react to that. But to not do anything because you're fearful of what if, then that's not living it.
Yeah, you know, you're talking too about trusting. And it's, I love how you brought up, that was great, bringing up the idea of at an event. I mean, for instance, there's always something that goes wrong. There's, I look at everything as an opportunity. That's how I frame it.
You know, like once in my 27 years, did everything work out exactly as it was planned, maybe?
Right.
But, and listen, tons and tons of happy accidents come out of that. That's not a bad thing, by the way. But to have the faith and the confidence. When I was a painter and I went to art school, I used to think about the abstract expressionists all the time. Like they had what was referred to as faith in the muck. So they would make a lot of mess with their paint. You know, you're Jackson Pollock and you're spraying the canvas with drips. And you had faith that somewhere in the muck of what you were doing, the image was going to come out of that. And you were going to find what that configuration of marks was or how that added up to being what the end result of the painting was. And I think about that a lot in business too. You know, you have to have faith in the muck and you have to have faith. Jackson Pollock had faith in his talents. He had faith that he would find that image, that picture through the process of working. I have that faith in what we do. There are times where I wish it wasn't as ambiguous. And Jackson Pollock certainly struggled with, you know, getting to that finish line and wondering whether that finish line was good enough. But, you know, if you have faith in the fact that you have a lot of abilities and your team has a lot of abilities, you'll get to a great place.
That is the perfect place to end this. I love that, David. I mean, I think that's something all of us can resonate with and use and really think about. So, well, I want to thank everybody for listening today to this episode of The Next Level. And Cindy Novotny of Master Connection Associates. If you missed the actual interview itself, be sure to check it out in more detail. Check out her site and services at masterconnection.com. Again, masterconnection.com. And that first interview of her was August 27th of 2018. And David, man, I want to thank you very much for sitting down with me.
Always a pleasure.
Yeah, love your insights. And I want to give David's site as well to check out, davidstarkdesign.com. Again, David Stark Design. And definitely, you all got to check out my first interview with David. We re-released it December 10th of last year, December 10. And stay tuned for my second interview of David coming up, which is going to be released in about a month or so. And if you enjoyed this episode, how could you not? Please share it with friends and colleagues. That's the best way that we can grow our community. So please share it and give it review. Also review it where you get your podcasts. And thanks again for listening to The Next Level. And we'll catch you next week with The Wedding Biz.